Secretary of Agriculture Tom Vilsack is causing a bit of a ruckus these days. He's telling every agricultural group he talks to that despite providing most of the country's fuel, food, and outdoor recreational spots, rural America is becoming irrelevant to politics. When we sat down to talk about that, the secretary told me you don't have to go far for proof.
It is unconscionable that we don't have a farm bill. This is just historic. You have every single major commodity group and farm group in the country united in the message to get this work done, yet Congress doesn't get it done. You can't point to a time when Congress has been this reluctant to pass farm legislation. And frankly, I think it's a reflection of this changing dynamic, and I think we better be paying attention to it and better do something about it.
So you think it's an easy one to ignore because there's not that pressure behind it of a political lobbying group, as it were?
Exactly. I mean, when the Speaker of the House basically says, look, we can't talk about the fiscal cliff and the farm bill at the same time because it's a 1,000-page bill. It's not a 1,000-page bill, first and foremost. It is a bill that could easily be attached to a hurricane relief bill or a fiscal cliff resolution bill, easily attached to either one of those, if you had the will, if it was a priority. When you consider what rural America does, it provides most of the food, a lot of the water, almost all of the energy and fuel, as well as many, many jobs connected to what happens in rural areas, there should be a greater appreciation for what takes place in rural America and a greater concern on the part of all of us to make sure that rural America is healthy and prosperous.
In the short term, it seems to me, the sales job has to be, why does anybody care if there's not a farm bill on January 1st? What will happen to me or my family sitting here in Washington, D.C.?
Well, if you like anything made with milk, you're going to be impacted by the fact that there's no farm bill. Because if there is not an extension of the existing bill or a new bill, basically on January 1st or shortly thereafter, permanent agricultural law goes back into place, 1949 law, which basically means that the government, the federal government, will go back in the business of strongly supporting, and I mean strongly supporting the dairy industry, by raising the price support, if you will, or support for dairy products to $38 a hundredweight. That's almost double what the price of milk is today. That's going to ultimately ramp up so that consumers, when they go in the grocery store, are going to be a bit shocked when instead of seeing $3.60 a gallon for milk, they see $7 a gallon for milk. And that's going to ripple throughout all of the commodities if this thing goes on for an extended period of time. So it impacts consumers. It impacts those of us who are concerned about the energy security of this country because the Farm Bill contains ways in which we can promote alternative energy sources, ways in which we can create a biofuel industry that's robust, that creates consumer choice. For those folks who are concerned about exports and the jobs that are connected in this country to agricultural exports, we lose the potential capacity to continue to promote and market exports without a Farm Bill. If you're concerned about the ability to provide adequate nutrition and you are a supporter of farmers markets and you want to see an expansion of those local and regional food systems, can't do it because there is no farm bill. If you like the idea of fields that expand habitat opportunities and you like to hunt or you like to fish, your hobby, your vocation, if you will, in that area is also going to be affected by no farm bill because a lot of the conservation programs are not extended or ended. If you're a farm family, obviously you're going to be impacted. So across the board, in virtually every aspect of our economy and a society, there is an impact and an effect by not having a farm bill.
Is this a failure on the part of this administration, on the part of this department, that there is not any urgency to this farm bill?
We have been talking, and the president's been talking about this, and I've been talking about it, and farm groups have been talking about it. It gets back to the original point that this interview started with, which is that the voice in rural America needs to be amplified. That's why it's important, and that's why I called for strategic alliances. We need to have better connections, better partnerships with groups around the country. We need to pick the right fights. We need to become a part of the country that embraces diversity of opinion and also diversity of population. I mean, there are many things that rural America needs to do in order to amplify this message so that it gets heard.
Let me ask you quickly about food stamps, which are a part of the SNAP program, which is part of this farm bill. Both sides of Congress want to cut the funding for that. It has grown, as you know, exponentially, hard economic times, and any number of reasons. But you have done some about waste, fraud, and abuse. Are there more places to cut in food stamps?
92% of recipients of this program are either senior citizens, people with disabilities, children of working families, people who are actually in the workforce. It's not understood. 14 cents of every food dollar that's spent at a grocery store ends up in a farmer's pocket. So it's part nutrition assistance. It's also part of the farm safety net. So it's an important program. It's misunderstood. It's another one of those aspects of our world here at USDA that's not fully understood. When you understand who you're helping here, and then it becomes a little bit more difficult to advocate for significant and massive cuts, as some have suggested.
Let me turn you to a subject that's very much in the news right now, and we now have a renewed conversation about gun control because of the horrific events in Newtown, Connecticut. And I wonder if you think, knowing Iowa as well as you do, knowing the Midwest as well as you do, dealing with rural America all the time, is it an easy sell to say we need to get rid of we need to ban semi-automatic weapons, we need to ban those multiple clips that are capable of shooting 30, 50, 100 bullets in a very short period of time, and we need to make sure that if there's gun shows, there are background checks, and that in private sales, there are background checks. Is that, will that be, because that's what the administration wants, will that be a tough sell where you come
from? You know, I don't think the president sees this as a sale. I think he sees it, and I think he's right about this, as a conversation in which the United States, the people of the United States, are all frustrated at the frequency and the severity of these horrific events, and that we should find common ground, some way of reaching that very difficult middle with reasonable policies and strong policies, but ones that respect the value systems that we're talking about here.
Do you see this as, and let's use a different word then, do you think that farmers, that rural America in general, is ready to say, yes, let's do these three things? Is that going to be tough for them to agree to?
I really believe that this is a different circumstance and a different situation, and I think the president believes it as well, that this is going to be a sustained conversation. So I think over time, as people think about this, as there are conversations, not just at the national level, but conversations that engage people at a local level. I mean, this is not a situation where it's simply a top-down effort. This is really a situation where the president recognizes that it's also grassroots up. And, you know, I'm in politics. I'm in politics because of an act of violence. The mayor of our town in 1986 was shot and killed by a disgruntled citizen who walked into a city council chamber and did a horrific act, which turned upside down a town of 8,000 people. And I will tell you that it has an impact and an effect, and it never leaves you. Here's how I view this. I view when the conversation starts, as this conversation started, with a respect for the Second Amendment and a recognition that there is a value system attached to it that is important. And it starts with a recognition that people do hunt and that's important to them. 38% of America either hunts or fishes. So, you know, it's a big part of the population. It's a much deeper conversation, and it's a good one to have for this country. It's potentially a unifying conversation. The problem is that these conversations are always couched in the terms of dividing us. This could be a unifying conversation, and Lord knows, we need to be unified.
And before I thank you for your time, are you in for another 4 years?
I'm here as long as the president's pleased with my service. At least that's what the certificate says. I've got a great job, and I'm privileged and honored to have it.
You're happy to keep it.
If I'm able to, absolutely.
Great. Mr. Secretary, thank you so much for your time this morning.
You bet.